Praise the Lord, God's children, because this is a day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Welcome to the Master's Word. I'm your host, Dr. Stefeni. My friends, all Master's Word programs are Christian internet radio and TV talk shows. They're directed at educating, edifying, and helping the body of Christ to gain understanding of God's Word and to know just who they are in Christ Jesus. Let's pray, shall we? Father, we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts, overflowing our lips. We praise you. We love you. We adore you. We thank you, Lord, that we can seek your face and you always illuminate your Word so that we gain proper understanding of it. We thank you for the Rhema Word of God, the Logos Word of God, for the gift of utterance, for revelation, knowledge, and manifestation of your Word alive and active in our hearts and lives. Bless those that have ears to hear, Lord, as we endeavor to know you more personally and love you more deeply. Holy Spirit, we invite you to take over this meeting right now in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. My friends, did you come expecting to receive? Well, if you didn't, then you can't expect to receive anything from God. So, my suggestion to you is that you'd better get ready to receive, raise that expectation level up, get it up there real high, because when you do, you're going to come away with a greater head and heart connection and understanding of God's Word. Now, we're moving deeper into the Word of God as we learn about being in Christ, and today we're looking still into the wonders of heaven. It'll be actually the very last of our series, this lesson is, and it's going to be done in two parts, so we'll pick it up on Monday, but anyway, it's the wonders of heaven, and we'll be discussing the Song of the Lamb. As I've told you, in these subjects, they're so deeply rooted in God that we need to worship in order to gain His presence in the degree that's necessary for us to gain total understanding of the message to us from God. So right now, let's just soak in preparation, shall we, in the love and the music of the Lord. I think that my microphone was off. I'm not sure. So, you know, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start this over again, just in case. I just feel so silly. At least let's pray, shall we, just in case? Because I just want to make sure that we have broadcasted this. You're listening to the Master's Word, just in case. But isn't that crazy? I just saw that my microphone was extremely weirdly off for some reason or other. Father, we come into your presence and we praise you and thank you for your word today, for all that you're going to impart. We thank you that our hearts are ready and cultivated and we're good ground to plant the word seed in. And we thank you for your Rhema word, your Logos word, and for the illumination of your word so that we gain proper understanding of it. Praise your name, Lord, and thank you for the gift of utterance as we go deeply into your word today and we come expecting to receive. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Once again, we're going to be talking today about the Song of the Lamb. And because these subjects are so deep, we need to soak in the presence of the Lord to be in that presence, in the depth that we need to be in. So let's start again, shall we? Praise the Lord. Can you tell the difference in how you feel when you've soaked in His presence? I'm telling you, it's just a magnificent thing. Today we're going to be talking to you once again about the Song of the Lamb. And the realm of the Spirit is a realm of music. And in this last area, we'll be talking about the realm of song and music. And I spoke to you many lessons ago in an earlier lesson, but not in depth about this, and we're going to go into it deeply here. Now, in the spirit world, living things have a song and have a music. It seems that there's no living object that doesn't carry a song or carry some melodic tune, vibration. In the spirit realm that God took me into, I was fascinated because I wondered what that sound was. It didn't exactly sound like an organ or a piano or any musical instrument, but there was a constant music going on all the time in the spirit realm. It was a sort of musical vibration that was sounding continually in the background. Sometimes it sounds like little rivers of water flowing in harmony, like babbling brooks. Then sometimes it sounds like the roar of like a giant waterfall, the crashing waterfalls. But it's not a roar of discord. It's a roar full of harmony. It's amazing. I can't describe it. Our natural ears can't pick up the fullness of the harmonies and the ongoing melodies of heaven's music. But in heaven, our eyes can see as far as we want to see. But on earth, our natural eyes can only see to a certain distance. In heaven, our ears will be able to hear as much as we want to, but there's a realm of music, a realm of song that's always there. And every object seems to be giving out a kind of music. Now, when there's heavenly scene, like let's say there's a heavenly tree, each live object has a different tune, and the tree gives off a sort of music of its own. The heavenly grass gives off a melody that it shares with us, its own music. And then the creatures in heaven, or the angels in heaven, when they speak, their voices have a musical quality. So some of you may have seen images of the angels talking to each other before, and they talk normally, but there's a musical quality to the sounds of their voices. As they're speaking, there's a kind of sparkle of music, which seems to harmonize with all the background music. I know this sounds weird, but it's true. So I entered the spirit realm while I was still down here on this earth. And here's the interesting part. While in the spirit realm, I also discovered that emanating from every human being, there's also a tune. Think on this for a minute. For those who have a heart condition, their normal heartbeat is music to their ears. Amen? Now, I read a story about a Christian who was claiming God's word for healing a heart problem, and his pulse was fixed to a heart machine. The sound of that machine goes troop, troop, and every time he hears that rhythm, he's very happy. So, to him, that's music to his ears. Amen? Okay. Now, inside each one of us, there is music, and there's vibration taking place all the time. Your heart is beating, so there's music going on all the time. I'm not talking about natural sound, folks. I'm not talking about that at all. Inside each one of us is a spiritual tune, and in that spirit world, you not only see a person, but you hear a person, not just when they speak. And when someone is in discord, their spiritual music is also in discord. Now, this spiritual tune that continually flows can be detected, and the sounds that come forth from those who are out of harmony with God are not music. That's the strange thing. You can tell a Christian by their song. Unbelievers who are not in harmony with God don't emit a harmonic sound. There's discord that flows. That's painful to the ears. It's like running your fingernails down a chalkboard. Ooh, even the thought of it made me chill. Now, Psalm 69, verse 34 says this, "Let heaven and earth praise him, the seas and everything that moves therein. Let everything worship him. Let everything praise him. Let all that have breath praise the Lord." Hallelujah. So there's a certain voice, there's a certain music in all of God's creation, in the birds, in the trees, wherever there is life, there's music. Now, why do we call it music? Music is basically just a harmony of movement and sound and vibrations, and when it's all harmoniously put together, we have what humans define as music. Now, when the planets move in their order, it's music in God's eyes and to God's ears. Music is the synchrony of sound, of movement, so there is a certain type of music emanated when there is perfection. Wherever perfection reigns, music results. So music is the perfect balance of all of God's creations. Now, when God first made the world, the Garden of Eden, and this planet Earth in its perfect state, everything vibrated with the harmony, the music of God. In the Garden of Eden, before the fall of man, all the earth was praising God. Every creature was praising God. The praise was coming forth because everything was in harmony in God's sight. If that's the case, we will take our definition a little further. Where perfection is, music results. Since God is perfection personified, God exemplifies music. Amen? God himself is the harmony of harmonies, the rhythm of rhythms, the source of all music, because from him flows perfection. God is perfect, and there is music in God. Now then, there is music in everything that God says, because God's word is perfect. And there is music in everything that God does, because his works are perfection. For where perfection reigns, music results. Okay? So when you say a word, it would produce harmony. Now, I'm going to take this a little further and deeper and give you an illustration from the realm of music. Let's say you have a choir or a band, and when you have a small discord, let's say one person is in discord and the other 99 are playing in harmony, do you think it would drown out that one disharmonic person? Of course it would. You'd hardly hear the disharmony. However, as the statistics increase from one person in discord to two, slowly the discordant sound becomes louder, more defining, more annoying. By the time you've reached to 10% of the populace there in the discord, the discord becomes quite obvious. Where music is concerned, it doesn't go by percentages. Let's say a person talks about going to heaven being based on good works and bad works, and they say that when they stand before the judgment seat of God, God will put all the bad works on one side, all the good works on the other side. If the scale just tilts a little bit on the bad side, you go to hell. If it tilts a little bit on the good side, you know, of the good works that you've done by having maybe given a cup of water to a thirsty man of God, then you go to heaven. That's what most religions believe until they come to Christianity. Then they realize that no man can enter heaven by their works. Now, what I'm trying to illustrate is this, that in some cases, a 50-50 balance makes a difference. In the realm of music, you don't need a 50-50 percent thing to weigh equally. Just 10% can destroy the whole orchestra. Okay? You don't need half the musicians to be bad to spoil the whole symphony. If there are only 7 musicians and 1 bad musician is enough to spoil the music. Get it? Okay. You see, music has a kind of quality that even if a small percentage is discordant, it's very obvious. So I'm trying to illustrate here that in the realm of the spirit, you don't need a big fat sin to qualify as a sinner. So why is that so? Well, it's because it works within the harmony that's flowing. There is a worldly discord that begins to drown out all the other things. But in God, there is no discord. His word is perfect. His works are perfect. So what happens? Well, this is what happens. Whenever there's a powerful harmony in comparison to a minor disharmony, that powerful harmony can affect that disharmony and change it into harmony. Let's use this tuning fork scenario again from my previous old lesson that I was talking about to illustrate. You strike a tuning fork, you have 2 of them, and you strike one and it begins to vibrate on a note. You hold up another tuning fork, you don't strike it, and just hold it there. What happens? The tuning fork you didn't strike begins to ring with the same tune of the one you did strike. Now, when we're in discord, God's word can cause harmony to begin once again in our hearts and minds. The word that is perfection, the word that is harmony, the word that is music when it flows into our lives, it causes a harmony to come forth. So in this way, every part of our system becomes tuned to the word of God. Now, what are we basing that tuning on? Every tuning has to be based on something. That tuning is based on what a person hears to be harmonies. There are two ways to tune a guitar, okay? You can either tune it to the other strings. However, if one of those strings was tuned incorrectly and the other four strings are tuned to that one string, you'll have five strings tuned to a harmony to that one string. And you have one more to tune, and when you tune it to the rest of the five, then they're all in harmony. But all are tuned to the wrong key, the wrong melody. In the same way, when God speaks His word, there's just full harmony. It's just full of harmony. It's overflowing with harmony. There's something within us that when God's word becomes powerful, it gets tuned up into God. Okay? Which is why God says in Colossians 3:16, when God's word is in abundance, not when it's in famine. Okay? Let's look at it. Colossians 3:16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, as you teach and admonish one another in all wisdom, and as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. When the word is abundant within us, every part of our being, the drums in us, the piano in us, the violins in us, all get tuned to the word, which is the basic tone or melody that we have to tune to. Then we become in tune with God. Now, in music, there is a standard key or note that blends well with all the other notes, and it's called the key of C. When a person tunes a guitar, they can tune it to D or tune it to E, or they tune it to a lower note. You know, when they do that and play the C chord, it's not really the key of C. It's actually a lower chord. What's happening here? Well, let me bring it into the realm of the human psyche. It's possible for a person to tune their inward being themselves, to a certain extent, that is, without God, through the powers of the human concentration, occult, yoga, or psychic concentration. They try to think all their inward being into a certain vibration. So let's say the word of God is middle C. Then you tune everything to middle C, and when you do, it harmonizes with the harmony of God, His melody. Now, without God, people are in discord. All of the internal parts of their soul are in discord. Some have bitterness, hurt, childhood experiences, terror, nightmares, and so on. Maybe even all those things. As they grow up, they're in discord. Now, do you wonder why their character's that way? Well, I'm trying to illustrate that life is music itself. Your character is music when it's perfect. Jesus is the perfect symphony. When a person's character is irritable and easily angered, do you know what's coming out? Discord. There are inner parts of our soul. There are inner parts of our spirit, and there are inner parts of our body, and they all flow together in harmony. So, what happens with those people, especially the occultic and the psychics, who try to reach into the spirit realm on their own without God? Well, let's say the word of God is middle C, and every part of our being is supposed to be tuned to that. But that occultic person is in discord. Doesn't God, they don't know God. I was going to say, doesn't God know that? I was backwards. They don't know God, all right? So they try to tune themselves. They try to reach that realm on their own by self. What happens is that instead of tuning to middle C, they end up tuning to D, so their soul, their dead spirit, is out of harmony with God's melody, and everything within them tunes to that discordance. They're definitely tuning to a song, but not the song of the Lamb. Now, the entrance into the spirit realm is through that harmony flow. So illegally, they try to enter that realm by tuning to a wrong note, and they manage to merely touch the surface of the spirit realm. Why? Because all the spirit realm contains all the notes. God created all the notes, and they have merely scratched the surface of that spirit realm just long enough for that evil spirit of discord to contact their soul and manifest. They gain extra strength from the demonic spirit where the human spirit is dead. It contacts the spirit, all right? It's where the human soul contacts the demonic soul and the demonic soul manifests. Where's that? The imagination, the dhyana. There is no protection in the spirit realm when you try to enter without God. I'll say that again. There is no protection in the spirit realm when you try to enter without God. But in that spirit realm of God, there is a song, a melody. There's an official entrance, and it's through Jesus Christ, the Word of God, that brings us into a continuous flow of the healthy realm of the Spirit. It's the song of the Lamb, the song of the Lord. That's why the closer your word resembles the word of the Lord, the closer your word contains the heavenly song and the heavenly melody. Now, I want to answer here a question that's often asked. Why is music linked to prophecy? Well, it is most often taught that there is a link between music and prophecy, between music and the office of a prophet. Now you know why. The reason is because when a prophet or a minister of prophecy contacts the word of the Lord and speaks it forth, it's perfect. It's the Lord's music, the Lamb's song. The reason why music opens an entrance into that prophetic realm to bring forth the utterance of God's word is because music is part of your tuning to the perfection of God through the music of God. Remember that God inhabits the praises of his people. At every point in history, in time and in church, when men and women of God of old have touched and spoken the words that are heavenly, it's always been on the song of the Lord. Moses reached a stage of almost perfection, made possible through the grace of God. Yet, he still has to be redeemed through the blood of the Lamb. But Moses walked, he had walked like no other man had walked. He had known God like no other man before him had known God. And at the peak of his ministry, as he approached the conclusion of his life, although he died, he was resurrected. The book of Jude tells us that God sent Michael to get the body of Moses because Moses was resurrected before the normal resurrection. He had walked too closely with God. The song of the Lamb was housed within the cells of his body. And when prophecy reached its greatest height, it became song and linked with music. Look at Moses in Deuteronomy 31:19. Now therefore write this song, and teach it to the people of Israel. Put it in their mouths, that this song may be a witness for me against the people of Israel. Okay, but that song also prophesies good blessings. And that word that was uttered forth at nearly 2000 BC continues on as the word of God, although it is known as the Song of Moses. We know that when God speaks a word, it will always come to pass, whether that word came directly from God, that word came from an angel, or that word came through the lips of man. That word contains the music of God. Even at the climax of the Jewish age, which Moses had looked forward to and prophesied of, we find that they are still singing the Song of Moses. One of the climaxes is in the book of Revelation, chapter 15, verse 3, where it says, "And they sing the song of Moses." See, that song has not been completed, even in the church age. But that prophetic song that was released will be completed in the Jewish dispensation after the rapture. You know, there have been men and women of God who have moved into that realm. When Paul was writing his epistles, he may not have realized it all by himself, but the music of God was flowing within him. And as he wrote those epistles to persons like Timothy, Titus, and to the churches, in his time, his words continue on through age after age, through generation upon generation, until today, the 21st century, the words of Paul still carry the same weight and authority. We call it the infallible word, but it came from a humble, ordinary pen and through a humble clay vessel. The guitar may be imperfect, but when a good guitarist strums a song, he'll still bring out the perfection of the melody. That explains why whenever there's music, the music of God and the praises and the worship of God, we sense the thus says the Lord of the Lord. And it's so much stronger. Why does prophecy come forth when music's played and sung? Well, it's because the music is harmony. In the book of 1 Chronicles, chapter 25, verses 1 through 3, it tells us this. David and the chiefs of the service also set apart for the service certain of the sons of Asaph, and of Hermon, and of Jeduthun, who should prophesy with lyres and harps and with cymbals. The list of those who did work and their duties was of the sons of Asaph, Zachar, Joseph, Nethaniah, Asriah, sons of Asaph, under the direction of Asaph, who prophesied under the direction of the king. Of Jeduthun, the sons of Jeduthun, Gedaliah, Zerai, Jeshiah, Shimel, Hashabiah, and Methathiah, six under the direction of their father, Jeduthun, who prophesied with lyre in thanksgiving and praise to the Lord. Have you ever wondered why prophecy and the harp music cymbals go together? Well, they were tuning to the song of God. Without music, mankind can't reach his highest aspiration. Great nations rise with great anthems, folks. Great disasters are overcome with a great song in the hearts of God's people. Go to the Olympics. When the winners win and they get the first place, they play their national anthem. You know, that's a great thing. It's said that, and it's true, that when the Japanese nation was conquered in the Second World War, the entire nation was devastated. They had lost hope in their religion. They had lost hope in anything that they had. But there was a song that came to them. Today, Japan is known as the Ninth Symphonies. Japanese call it number 9. That symphony by Beethoven took the hearts of the Japanese people and gave them back the hope, the desire to rise again. It was performed yearly, and the crowds that gathered kept getting bigger and bigger. The CD of that symphony contains 74 or 76 minutes. I can't remember which, but anyway, it's either 74 or 76. Now, why such an odd number? Why not 60 or 90 minutes? Because that's what they normally are. Because when they recorded it, The Nine was so popular that they said we must modify the CD so that all the nine symphonies can fit onto the one CD. That's the history of the 74-76-minute CD. Beethoven's music raised up the people of Japan, even though Beethoven himself may never have even met a Japanese. But his music lives on, and that nation today has risen. Now, my friends, that's just natural music. Think about the Song of the Lamb. There is a relationship between natural and spiritual, and we humans love and draw towards harmony. People flee disharmony and riotous chaos. People are drawn towards harmony. We draw towards harmonies in the same way that there's a drawing towards God, and music helps us to get there. Which explains why in 2 Kings chapter 3, when Elisha had to prophesy, he said, "Bring me a minstrel." As he hears the minstrel play, the Spirit of the Lord came on him. Now, the closer we get to God, the more musical we become. And I'm out of time. Boy, am I. So we'll pick this up on Monday, where we will discuss getting into the realm of harmony. All right? But right now, let's just continue on and close out this session. I hope that you received this today, and I hope you got something really good out of it. I pray that you did. If you have questions or need further assistance with understanding the message, please contact me. I can be reached at masterstouchhs@cox.net. That's masterstouchhs@cox.net, poet@cox.net, poet@cox.net, or mthsprayer@cox.net. That's mthsprayer@cox.net. Or you can come through the website, themasterstouch.org. That's themasterstouch.org, and my webmail there on the website is drstefeni@themasterstouch.org. That's drstefeni @themasterstouch.org. I want to invite you to join us every Monday at 10 a.m. Pacific time for Living the Word. Pastor Karen Weitzman and I will be bringing you the explanation and practical application of God's Word and promises to your life today. This is a live broadcast on Spreaker.com every Monday at 10 a.m. right here on Spreaker. In addition, you are also invited to join us for the Master's Touch Masterclass every Monday at 9 a.m. and Tuesday at 10 a.m. here on Spreaker.com. Now, you're going to enjoy a complete Bible college ministry level study on discipleship into being in Christ. And I want you to understand that this discipleship is not into a denomination or church doctrine. I'll be teaching you true discipleship into the body of Christ. Now, although these classes are on a ministerial level, they are for every believer. And we'll begin at the beginning of creation, and we're going to move all the way into your salvation and the gifts of the cross given to us by Christ. You'll learn what your purpose is in God's having created you and your call, how to step into that calling, what to expect when you do, hey, and what to expect when you don't. You'll discover the power you have, how to operate in it, and why you have it. And then we'll finish up not with the end, but our true and eternal beginning. Don't miss any of these classes. But if you can't make it to the meetings or broadcasts, then we're archiving these classes after each broadcast on Spreaker.com and also on themasterstouch.org. It's our website. And you can go to the page that says the master's class. And it'll take you to those broadcasts. Don't you think it's time that you understood your purpose here? What are you doing here, anyway? Come join us every Monday at 9 a.m., Tuesday at 10 a.m. Pacific time, and come expecting to receive. And then, of course, on Tuesdays at 9:30 a.m. Pacific time, we bring you Sweet Hour of Prayer. And this program is designed to teach you what prayer is, why we pray, how to pray to receive the desired results every time you pray. Join us every Tuesday at 9:30 a.m. Pacific time on Ustream.tv. And come expecting to receive. My brethren, Proverbs 4, verse 7 tells us wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom, and with all you're getting, get understanding. Well, that's exactly what we're doing here, my friends, gaining God's wisdom. Therefore, make sure you're keeping Jesus Lord of your life. You know, as born-again believers, we are in Christ, therefore 1 John chapter 4, verse 17 applies to us. And it tells us that as Jesus is, so are we in this world. How is he? He's strong, so are we. He's abundant, so are we. He's full of life and divine health and wholeness, and so are we. He's able to do the works of the Father successfully, so are we. As Jesus is right now, right here, this minute, so are we in this world. So, my friends, meditate on that scripture until you become it. 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. You know, the Master's Word is a subsidiary of the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International. We're a 501c3 organization. Have a safe and wonderful weekend. God bless you, and I look forward to seeing you on Monday. Just God bless you. Have a great weekend.